So it's a great pleasure for me now to introduce Professor Monika Hasenbring. She's Professor of Medical Psychology and Head of the Department of Medical Psychology and Sociology at the Ruhr University in Bochum and here in Germany. And as well, she's an adjunct professor in the Faculty of Health Science, Southern University of Denmark. So her main interest in science are the field of psychobiological pain research and psycho-oncology, as far as I know. And in pain research, she deals a lot with biopsychological risk factors and the mechanisms, if they play a role from acute to chronic pain in musculoskeletal pain as well. She published a lot. We found over 60 papers on her account, and now it's a pleasure for me to give you the stage, Monika. Thanks a lot for being here.
Thanks very much, Frank, and also to Petra and the organizers to invite me. It's really an honor to be invited to this lecture and talk about psychosocial and biopsychosocial mechanisms of physical activity. My title is Physical Activity and Biopsychosocial Moderation in Low Back Pain. And I'd like to question how to conceptualize health-promoting behavior. As Deborah Faller has outlined before, low back pain in the general population and in the athletes has show very high prevalence in both groups of people or patients. Chronic low back pain is indeed a disabling condition in the general population, causing high costs for treatments, for a lot of treatments for a long time. In work, absenteeism, and also in the effect of early retirements. And in athletes, we have the problem of an inability to conduct the training as recommended, or a reduced ability to conduct the training, an inability or reduced ability to take part in the competition, or in some cases also given up the career. The management of low back pain aims to decrease these kinds of disability by the way of an increase of physical activity. But the crucial question is how are these both terms related? The relation between physical activity on the one hand and low back pain intensity and the occurrence of low back pain on the other. And I think one of the crucial questions is how can we define a level of physical activity that is really health promoting and not only thinking about a simple increase of physical activity. Physical activity and low back pain in the general population, as Petra said in the beginning, in the introduction, we mostly talk about sedentary behavior that is related to low back pain, and it's indeed unquestionable that long-time sedentary behavior is positively related to low back pain. But we also can see in the general population that in occupational workloads with frequent lifting, bending, twisting, postures causing high spinal load are also risk factors for the occurrence and also for the maintenance of low back pain. In athletes, I think we seldom talk about sedentary behavior as a risk factor, but we talk about high loads on the spine caused by repetitive mechanical strain, by static or dynamic extreme body positions. These factors may increase the occurrence and maintenance of low back pain. And I formulated, use the term may, because here there is a great need for further research in the role of these kinds of risk factors in the occurrence and in the maintenance of low back pain. In the general population, several authors such as Campello in 69 still, or Erbenheim from a task force in French from 2000, suggested a U-shaped function between the amount of physical activity and the occurrence and also the intensity of back pain, assuming that very low levels of physical activity you can see on the left side, but also very high levels of physical activity may be related to an increase of back pain. And one of the first studies that have shown this U-shaped function was the study of Hennever in the Netherlands and Belgium, a collaboration. They investigated a Dutch population-based sample of representative cohort of more than 3,000 people and found a clear support for this U-shaped function. And also one of our PhDs in our MiSpEx consortium, I will talk about later, found these U-shaped functions, and I come back to this point later on. Physical activity is a behavior, and behavior is guided by our cognitions, and so I come to the psychosocial components, by our cognitions and by our emotions, for example. In general, pain in daily life always causes a certain goal conflict. We are in conflict whether we should direct our attention to the pain stimulus on the left side or to the activities we are engaged in daily life. This is true whether we are engaged in daily life activities such as gardening, and it's also true for high-performance athletes and their engagement in sports activity. If we focus on the pain stimulus, we come very often to an interruption of activity, looking for a physician, looking for pills in order to reduce this pain. In the other case, if we focus our attention towards the activities in daily life, we tend to persist in this in such a moment in this kind of activity and tend to endure pain. In some cases, people learn long life, and these strategies may recur to long life learning processes, beginning sometimes in early childhood. People learn automatic ways to automatically respond to their pain in one of these both ways. And in the avoidance-endurance model, we described several pathways and psychosocial patterns of how what we think when we experience pain, how we feel when we experience pain, and what do we do when we experience pain. For example, we can describe a so-called fear-avoidance pathway where people tend to automatic cognitions of catastrophizing. What does it mean? It means that we have automatic thoughts that comes in our mind within seconds. For example, the thought, I can have a tumor, can I? Or another thought, this activity would terribly increase my pain. Or if this pain maintains, I will never be able to take part in the next competition, for example. And the tend to catastrophizing leads to increased levels of fear and anxiety in our emotions, and in some patients also to avoidance behavior. And when people in the general population first tend to avoid and escape all certain activities that may increase pain, they run the risk to develop some kinds of muscular underuse or maladaptive patterns of motor adaptations, for example, and by these ways they run the risk of developing chronic phases of their acute pain. This model describes the next pathway. Okay. Some people do respond differently. They respond in their cognitions with cognitions so-called thought suppression. That mean cognitions like pull yourself together or don't make such a fuss or an Indian does not know any pain. And they often emotionally respond with anxiety, with increased depressive mood, or also with anger or irritated mood. And in the case, these patients tend to increase of endurance behavior and persistence in these kinds of activities. They run the risk of developing some kinds of muscle overload, and by this way, the way into chronic pain. The model describes a third maladaptive way, responding to pain with slightly different cognitions, with a cognition of focused distraction. This means that we distract on a task, for example, or on a nice situation. Think on this task, it's great. Think on the next competition. Think on your chance to win this competition or so. And pathway is often associated with positive mood despite pain. And when these patients or when these people tend to increase and maintaining endurance behavior, they also, on the behavioral level, they run the risk of muscle overload and development of chronic pain. Is there a way out? Yes, there might be a way out. If people, show cognitions we call coping signal, for example, have a short break, go on thereafter, feeling slightly distress, it's normal to feel distress when having pain, but coming to a flexible balance between healthy kinds of avoidance and healthy kinds of endurance, or healthy kinds of balance between stress and recovery. You talked about the at the Congress, at the conference, the last days I have seen. And we suggest that these people come to a moderate load and to a balance of loads and relaxation. And by this way, they contribute, by this way of behaving and feeling and thinking, they contribute to the reduction of pain. I would like to show you some data from the general population from former studies on two aspects. One is the aspect whether these groups develop different kinds of pain. And we have here investigated, for example, one sample of 177 patients. They suffered from subacute pain. Subacute pain has a duration of less than 3 months. And they were investigated in practices in primary care. And we looked for the development of pain and disability from the start of their treatment until a 6 month follow-up. And what we had, you can see on the left side, is that at the baseline, at the start of the treatment, all high-risk groups showed higher level of pain than the adaptive patients. And these levels were relatively stable. The distress endurance patients showed a significant further increase. The blue line are the fear avoidance patients. They showed a stable level, and the oestrus endurance showed a slightly decrease, but a higher level of pain at the follow-up. So they showed indeed signs of chronification of pain over this six-month period. In their disability, it's interesting that only three of these high-risk groups, only the fear avoidance patients and the distress endurance patients, showed high levels of disability. The oestrus endurance showed a low level of self-reported disability comparable to the adaptive patients. And these levels were relatively stable over time. The next question was whether the high-risk groups showed different signs of activity. We assumed that the fear avoidance patients would show real, they suffer from high disability, and we suggested that they will indeed show very low levels of activity if we assess activity objectively, not by self-report data. And we had the hypothesis that both endurance groups show signs of overactivity and the adaptive patients might show moderate activity. We assessed physical activity using accelerometers with a, here in this case, the Dynaport developed in the Netherlands. And we are able to assess a number of parameters using this advice. What we show you here are data concerning an 8 hours period of a typical working day and analyzed the general physical activity level and, what it's more interesting to us, the number of constant postures, CPs, the number of constant postures, that means the number of positions people took in upright or forward bend, sitting and standing in this kind. And what we have seen can you see in this graph, we used on the ordinate T-scores. These scores are used to standardize all questionnaire data and physical activity data. And you can see that the adaptive patients with respect to the self-report data in pain, in disability, and in fatigue had the lowest scores, as we expected. And in pain, all three high-risk groups showed increased and significantly more and higher levels of pain than the adaptive patients, a further support of this relevance of these groups concerning their pain. When you look for a disability, you can see that the fear avoiders showed the highest level of disability and also the highest level of fatigue. The distress endurance patients showed also very high levels of fatigue and moderate disability. And as in the study before, the all stress endurance and adaptive patients showed low levels of disability and fatigue. And how does these groups occur in their accelerometer data? The physical activity level, the PAL level, was not so significant. It's only a trend, but the sample size was rather small, a little. But highly significant were the differences in the constant postures, in the number of constant postures. And we have seen that, for example, the distress endurance patients, despite their high level of pain and despite their subjective self-reported disability, they feel disabled and they feel highly fatigued, but they show the highest number of constant postures, but or because. And the second high level was seen in the all stress endurance patients of constant postures. The adaptive patients were in the middle, and the fear avoidance patients, as expected, showed the lowest level of constant postures and at a trend also in the general physical activity level. In a second sample, which was a bit larger now, we found the same picture with more pain in all high-risk groups compared to the adaptive on the right side. And on the left side, the fear avoiders showed also in this study the lowest level of constant postures, the endurance groups the highest, and the adaptive group were in the middle. Just recently, last year, a group from Australia has published a great study investigating transient physical and psychosocial activities in the risk of developing low back pain after a 12-month follow-up period. And what I would like to show you is merely that the highest odds ratios were seen for high physical workload and also for awkward postures, with extremely high odds ratios in the development and prediction of the development of chronic pain. And this is further support for the meaning of awkward postures and high workload as a risk factor concerning high activity in the general population. Fear avoidance and endurance in athletes. What's about? I would like to focus on several data on the athletes. on the prevalence of these AAM subgroups in athletes, on the association of pain and intensity and disability with these AAM subgroups. And I will focus on the question, how are these patterns related to training behavior? What about the risk of major depression? Because we know that major depression is a bad consequence and a long-term consequence of chronic back pain in the general population. And the question, can we screen for fear avoidance and endurance? These data came from the National Research Network for Medicine and Spine Exercise, the MiSpEx-Network, managed by Frank Meyer and Petra Platen. And this is a research network in Germany consisting of 13 partners, and they have one goal, to develop diagnostics treatments and transfer strategies for low back pain in the general population and also in athletes. The first question, prevalence of avoidance-endurance pain response pattern in athletes, how often they are. Here, I would like to show you data from two different studies. This study is a study in subacute low back pain with a duration of less than 3 months. We conducted together with Petra Platen and her group. And what we have seen that in a former sample of a general population, patients in primary care, these are the blue bars, most patients showed, more than 54%, showed an adaptive pattern. The other are between 10, 17, and 19%. In the athletes, in the athletic sample we investigated with subacute low back pain, we saw a rather lower level, percentage of people with an adaptive pattern, but the highest with an stress endurance pattern. This was the pattern of people who are able to distract from their pain when they have pain, to establish a positive mood despite pain and to endure in their activities. How is it in chronic low back pain? In the second study in our network, how we define athletes. The definition of athletes is still under debate, but I would like to mention that we defined athletes as based on an activity in competition sports in high, meaning international and national, or medium on a regional level. So what about chronic low back pain patients? And here we have data from a study came from a collaboration with Michael Kelman from the Ruhr University and Jens Kleinert from the Sports University in Cologne. And in this collaboration, we compared chronic low back pain patients with athletic patients, all are under treatment, with the former sample, with another sample of primary care patients with chronic back pain. And what we can see in the general population, the blue bars, that the percentage of adaptive patients were lower, and we had an increase in distress endurance. Even in chronic back pain, we have a high number of oestrus endurance patients in the athletes, but also a certain number of people who show distress endurance now in the chronic phases. These are both cross-sectional studies. We do not know anything about the development from subacute to chronic phase. That's another question. What's about the association with pain intensity and disability and also with training behavior? In the subacute sample, we saw that all high-risk groups, you can see at the left side, the fear avoidance, distress endurance, and also the oestrus endurance patients, showed a significant higher level of pain than the adaptive. And as in the general population, it's the same pattern. The distress endurance and the fear avoidance patients showed higher disability compared to both other groups. This disability measures disability in daily life, at work, at housework, and school, and in leisure time. And we also looked for disability in training activities in the athletes and also in taking part of the, in a competition. And here we have seen that even the fear avoidance and the distress endurance patients showed higher level of disability concerning training and also concerning the real participation in a competition. They feel, these both groups feel disabled and more disabled than both other groups. This corresponds with the high pain. If we look for the real training activity we assessed by a questionnaire, we can see that the training frequency was highest in the distress endurance patients, despite the highest level of pain and despite very high level of a disability, field disability. And also the combined score of hours people spent in their work in a week and added the training, we can see that the distress endurance patients showed the highest activity levels we have seen in these groups. The other study in chronic pain patients, together with Michael Kelman and Jens Kleinert, we had the opportunity to have a follow-up at the 6 months, and here all athletes, these were people with chronic pain, all were under physiotherapy, and we were interested in the question which groups develop chronic pain and what's about the development over a 6 month period of physiotherapy. And concerning pain, you can see on the left side that again the distress endurance and fear avoidance showed the highest level of pain at the follow-up. So the high level they showed in an early phase of physiotherapy, they also showed at a 6 month follow-up. There was no change. The oyster's endurance seemed to profit from these kinds of physiotherapy, and the adaptive patients too. We also had time and athletes interaction. You can see at the right side that at the follow-up, the athletes showed a higher level of pain than the non-athletes, of low back pain. And below, you can see the data concerning disability, and you can see again the same pattern that the fear avoidance and distress endurance showed highest disability with only a slight or non-significant decrease over time. And the oyster's endurance and adaptive patients were below. Interesting, we have an interaction between the AEM groups and the athletes. And you can have an impression if you compare both graphs. You can see at the right side the disability scores in baseline and follow-up in the athlete group. And you can see that you have a stable level and no a decrease of disability. The lowest level was seen in the adaptive patients, the second in the oyster's endurance, the second in the distress endurance, and the highest level in the fear avoidance. What's about the risk of major depression? We can screen the risk for a possible major depression by the back depression fast screen. Score above 4 indicates with a high sensitivity and high specificity the risk for major depression. And what we have seen in both samples in the chronic patients, that the fear avoidance patients and the distress endurance patients revealed a really high risk of developing a major depression. And this was the same in the large sample of subacute patients with subacute low back pain. Can we screen for fear avoidance and endurance? And I have to admit that we, since 20 years, we are engaged in the development of screenings, and we started with a screening instrument questionnaire measuring the groups by nearly 200 items. And in between, we shortened these. It's not a screening with 200 items. We shortened it up to 36, and the second version and the third version with 25. And the MiSpEx consortium force us nearly to shorten, to shorten, to shorten. They insisted upon a very short screening. And though we looked whether it's possible, and it seems that we can get a sufficient predictive power with the avoidance-endurance fast screen. It consists of 9 items. As you can see, it's a questionnaire with 7 items measuring persistence behavior and 2 items shortened from the and derived from the back depression inventory measuring distress, emotional distress, depressive mood. And we have seen here a rock curve that is sufficient with an area under the ground of 0.69 and sensitivity of 0.81 and a specificity of 0.66. So we can screen and are able to build these groups with in a very short time. So I would like to summarize and conclude. The relation of physical activity and low back pain seems to follow a U function and not a linear function. Fear avoidance and endurance pattern are predictive of pain, disability, and depression in athletes and non-athletes, with higher prevalence of endurance in the athletes, as we expected, and you too, I think. The AAM subgroups correspond to low, high, and medium levels of physical activity, especially in high load positions when we use accelerometer data. And indeed, we can screen by using a short questionnaire for these IEM subgroups and individuals with low back pain. And these screenings are used to offer patients individually tailored treatment approaches. And I would like to conclude that the development of health-promoting physical activity should consider not only number of hours of activity per week, for example, but a broader concept of cognition behavior included in learning processes. And so I am at the end, and I have a very short video showing how we can explain a patient these maladaptive behavior strategies in a physiotherapy session. I don't know whether we have time. Petra? Would we have time?
Oh, yes, of course.
Okay. Oops, yes, I have to look. It's in German, but we have English subtitles.
Oh ja, ich merke, Ihre Muskulatur ist ziemlich verspannt. Haben Sie sich heute schon sehr belastet?
Ja, ein bisschen schon. Ja.
Ein bisschen schon, was haben Sie denn schon alles gemacht?
Ja, erstmal so das normale Prozedere, also Kinder wecken, Frühstück machen. Und als die Kinder zur Schule gegangen sind, habe ich dann erstmal über Staub gewischt, das Bad geputzt und dann Staub gesaugt.
Okay, und wann sind die Schmerzen heute zum ersten Mal aufgetreten?
Ja, beim Staubsaugen.
Okay, Pause bitte. Mhm. Und was haben Sie denn gemacht, als die Schmerzen auftraten?
Ich habe einfach weitergemacht, die Arbeit muss ja gemacht werden.
Ja. Was geht Ihnen dann so durch den Kopf, wenn die Schmerzen auftreten?
Was mir so durch den Kopf geht? Nichts Besonderes. Also ich denke, dass ich einfach durchhalten muss, die Arbeit fertigstellen muss und dann versuche ich den Schmerz zu ignorieren und ihn einfach nicht mehr wahrzunehmen.
Okay, und welche Gefühle begleiten Sie dabei?
Ach, ich bin allgemein fröhlicher Mensch und mache meine Arbeit sowieso immer Spaß.
Das heißt, wenn Sie die Schmerzen verspüren, dann versuchen Sie diese zu ignorieren, machen Ihre Arbeit weiter und denken sich, okay, muss ja irgendwie gemacht werden.
Ja, das haben Sie richtig verstanden.
Und was macht das mit Ihrem Rücken? Verstärkt das den Schmerz oder was passiert da?
Ja, das kann sein, dass es schon schlimmer wird, aber ich versuche den ja meistens so wegzudenken, dann geht das ja.
Gelingt Ihnen das den ganzen Tag, den Schmerz wegzudenken?
Es geht. Ich bemühe mich.
Ja. Ich habe so den Verdacht, dass der Umgang mit Ihrem Schmerz vielleicht nicht der richtige ist. Also dass es da vielleicht Optimierungsmöglichkeiten gibt. Und ich würde Ihnen gerne mal die Zusammenhänge erklären, wenn das in Ordnung ist. Zunächst einmal ist zu sagen, dass der Schmerz ein Körper des Signales ist. Dass der Schmerz ein Signal des Körpers ist, dass er eine Pause braucht. Ja, also wenn Sie sich körperlich viel belasten, dann tritt in der Muskulatur ganz viel Spannung auf. Und je weiter Sie sich belasten, desto größer wird die Spannung. Und wenn Sie zwischendurch keine Pause machen, dann hat auch die Muskulatur keine Möglichkeit, sich zu entspannen. Sie haben ja erzählt, dass Sie morgens, wenn Sie aufwachen, keine Schmerzen haben oder nur wenige. Und dass das dann im Verlauf des Tages, je mehr Sie sich belasten, mehr wird. Das ist ja ein Zeichen dafür, wenn der Körper zur Ruhe kommt, dann gehen auch die Schmerzen weg. Ja? Von daher wäre meine Idee, dass Sie, wenn Sie merken, dass der Schmerz schlimmer wird, eine kleine Pause machen. Sich mal kurz hinsetzen, wirklich bewusst auch in den Rücken reinspüren, wie der Schmerz nachlässt und dabei vielleicht einen Tee oder Kaffee trinken. Und wenn Sie merken, okay, die Spannung lässt ein bisschen nach, dann weiterzumachen.
Ich glaube, ich habe gar nicht so viel Zeit im Laufe meines Tages, so viele Pausen zu machen. Das ja. ist das Problem.
Vielleicht sind das gar nicht so viele Pausen und ich könnte mir auch vorstellen, dass wenn Sie die Pausen machen, Sie die Arbeit anschließend noch viel besser erledigen können, weil Sie dann nicht mehr damit beschäftigt sind, den Schmerz wegzudenken oder sich überhaupt mit dem Schmerz auseinanderzusetzen. Und langfristig muss es eben das Ziel sein, dass diese Dauerspannung aus der Muskulatur rausgeht. Zusammen mit den Übungen, die wir hier gemeinsam machen, sollte das dann auch irgendwie in nächster Zeit gut funktionieren, dass die Schmerzen insgesamt weniger werden. Wollen Sie das vielleicht einfach mal bis zu unserem nächsten Termin ausprobieren? Und dann gucken wir, wie das in Ihren Alltag passt.
Das könnte ich machen, also bis zum nächsten Mal gucke ich das mal auf. Machen wir da einen Tee oder so.
Okay, gut, dann verbleiben wir so.
Ja, danke schön.
Ja.
Tschüss.
Tschüss.
Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, Monika and Deborah, would you like to come here?
Okay. Are there any questions from the audience? The floor is open for discussion right now.
I have one.
Alex, please.
Yes. My name is Alexander Ferrauti from one of the hosting universities. Hello. Thank you for the great talks. The question is to Deborah Faller. And one of your findings was that during strength endurance exercise with a lot of repetitions, the healthy controls change their inter or intramuscular coordination during the repetitions until the end, while the back pain patients kept that constant. But I did not recognize, I think you did not give us the explanation for that. And another aspect could be, would that not be the starting key point for interventions?
Yeah, okay, so first point, I didn't give you an explanation because I think it's very difficult to give an explanation. I think from what we've seen, and we've seen across a number of other studies as well, is that you know, it doesn't matter if it's the lumbar rectus spinae, the trapezius, we do see this adaptation with prolonged tasks. And we see that the activity tends to shift consistently in the same direction. My guess is that it's based on the efficiency of the muscle fibers to perform the task. So I think it comes down to anatomical considerations and then the neural control of the muscle is to optimize you know, the strategy for the task. And in terms of implementation into management, absolutely. And we're trying to now look at feedback. So giving people feedback on them from the high density EMG and asking them to try to use that visual information to control the muscles. And we have been able to see, and again, this is very preliminary, but that with the visual feedback, people have the capacity to voluntarily shift the activation.
Thanks.
That's preliminary.
Deborah, another question to you. As far as I got it, high density EMG is considering the amplitude information, right?
Is there?
You could also extract other features from it, but that's, I focus on the amplitude.
Yeah, so that would be my question. Is there any difference in information if you look at the amplitudes or if you look at the time domain?
So we've looked at, in terms of the studies that I presented, we've only looked at the amplitude and we've looked at the mean frequency as a marker of fatigue. And so we were able to demonstrate, for example, that there was a greater decline in the mean frequency also in the patient group, which is, again, a marker of fatigue. So I think there are certainly other approaches with the high-density EMG decomposition to extract motor unit behavior is possible from the high-density EMG. So there are other measures that can be done. But for those studies, we only focused on largely the amplitude and shift in the amplitude and also the mean frequency.
Thank you very much for excellent presentations. My question is for Monica. Other than the questionnaires that you mentioned in your presentation, were there other measures of disability that were used? For example, in the States we use S-Westry form. What was the exact measurements, questionnaires, whatever, that you used for disability?
Mm-hmm. Yes, in these studies in the athletes, we used a very short measure, the von Korff disability score. It consisted of three items, of experienced disability in daily life, at work, and in leisure time. And especially in the athletes, the group of Petra has also included some self-ratings with a similar manner as the von Korff, but concentrated on the ability to take part in training or in competition, especially for the athletes. In former studies in the general population of our group, we also used the pain disability index, the PDI, for example, as a 10-item measurement. Also in some studies, the Oswestry disability score, but the results didn't differ significantly.
Thank you.
Can I ask another question to Monica? First of all, sorry for forcing you to go the orthopedic way and just reducing all your questionnaires, but you know, for us it's quite important. So let me just ask one question. If I got it right, the fourth type of your model is the only single and only one that makes sense, basically, at the end. So how can we deal with that in our high-performance athletes? Because we cannot tell our athletes during the season, just go on with moderate activity, just take a stop. At least the coaches will never accept that. So would that mean that whenever we have an athlete with acute or subacute low back pain, that we will have to have the risk that they will this will lead to chronification within the season, and we just can treat them beside the season, or what shall we do with our high performance athletes?
First let me say that this statement you made is the same statement as non-athletes present me when I talk about possible breaks during working time. Most patients in the beginning say, oh, at my workplace, it's absolutely impossible to introduce a short break. And we can see that inspecting the very concrete surroundings of a certain working place, we, in any case, are able to include some kinds of breaks. These could breaks to go 5 minutes for toilet, others go for smoking outside. It could be breaks of very still breaks, only closing eyes and have a severe breathing and an intense breathing to relax, for example. So we can find, dependent from the individual situation, possibilities to make a break. And I would suggest that it's also possible in sports, and not during a competition, but also during in a season, in heavy training season, I think it's possible. But the most crucial things, when we start to introduce, for example, breaks, the most task for psychologists is to deal with the anxieties, with the fear of interruption of the activity.
My name is Veit Sander from Technical University of Munich. That's a question to Deborah. Deborah, the high density EMG is still surface EMG, so it's a sum of the deeper muscles and those to the surface. So if we had, we don't, but if we had a system that was able to just determine the activity of the deeper muscles, would you then use it and maybe speculate, would you expect other results more without the crosstalk of the bigger muscles and the surface muscles?
So the current grids that we use for the for surface EMG, they have a relatively small intraelectrode distance, so we really are picking up superficial muscle activity, so we're not really getting that deeper layer. There are some fine wire EMG electrodes that are being made with multi-channels. I've never used them. It could be interesting, but so it's literally like a series of, obviously not hundreds, but multiple channels on a within a intramuscular electrode, which potentially could allow us to look at distribution of activity within the deep muscles. But so I think the technology is changing, developing, and progressing quite rapidly. So no doubt in a few years' time we'll be doing that. It would be interesting.
Yeah, well, I'm thinking about something like a thermography methods, okay, or ultrasound, because that is used in
technology. Sure, there are other
methods.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So I'm just wondering, does it make sense from your aspect to go into this development? Because maybe if you expect other results, maybe just looking at the deeper muscles, maybe it's more selective than...
Sure. I mean, we've certainly learned over the years that the deep muscles tend to behave differently than, you know, in general, than some superficial muscles in people with spinal pain. So I think there's definitely an indication to want to understand that further and understand deep muscle behavior further in the way that we're doing so with superficial muscles. So yeah, I think it would be definitely justified.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Valentina Camomilla from Rome. I'm not familiar with the psychological perspective, so this may be a naive question, but I was wondering if the level of pain could trigger a change in the behavioral response. So a fear avoidance could come into place where the level of pain increases with respect to other approaches, adaptive approaches, when the level of pain is lower.
Yeah, the fear avoidance and also the endurance develop more pain, and it's a hypothesis that it's due to low levels of activity and muscle underuse, for example, or muscle overuse. What I would be interested in, the question when I heard lecture from Deborah, is whether these subgroups may show different modes of motor behavior, of different modes of slowing the behavior or a different pattern of EMG activity, for example, in the overusers or underusers, when I simplify these groups, and have some more support for the assumption that this kind of behavior will indeed lead to more pain. Yeah, the mechanisms that are necessary to lead to more pain are under research.
Okay, thanks a lot. So it's my task right now to thank both outstanding presenters for their great talks, your contribution by handing over this symbol of active living, our coal miner with the name printed on it. So Deborah, thanks a lot for your contribution. You. It was great to have you here. Thank you. Monica, for you also, so that you remember the sports science community. Okay. And of course Frank, for you. Thanks for your contribution. So, I think we have lunchtime right now, and be sure that you will all come back this afternoon and stay till the closing ceremony is finished. Have a nice afternoon.
I just wanted to ask if you did already